This lesson is about operation scheduling. Scheduling and workplace planning is the final step in operation planning and design. Operation scheduling and workplace planning is implemented during transformation of input into output. As you know, the fundamental model of operation is input, transformation, and output. So, in this lesson, we will talk about what is operation scheduling. Scheduling deals with production of required quantity and product within the required time frame. It also deals with both time allocation and resource allocation of production of required quantity so that we can have a control on the productivity. Proper scheduling will always help us in increasing the efficiency of the process or the production system. Let's see what are the objective of today's class. First, we will try to understand work center. What is work center? Typical scheduling and control functions. What is basically the job shop scheduling? And we will discuss some example of scheduling rules. What is shop floor control? So in this lesson, we will try to satisfy the objectives which we have already defined right now. We will also discuss the principles of work center scheduling. What are the various issues in scheduling service personnel? So, let us first define what do you mean by work center in operation management. Here you can see the definition of work center. A work center is an area in a business in which productivity resources are organized and work is completed. Basically, workplace planning deals with allocation of resources with priority to work job with first delivery date. It is very useful in job shop type of process where the different types of jobs comes to the production system. And we have to decide which job should be loaded first so that the due dates can be met. So here you can understand what do you mean by work center in operations. It can be a single machine, a group of machine, or an area where a particular type of work is done. Now, we will also talk about capacity and scheduling here. There are different kind of loadings. One is infinite loading, finite loading, forward scheduling, and backward scheduling. There are different types of manufacturing scheduling processes and scheduling approaches. And these approaches are based on the types of process. As we know, there are four types of systems or the production processes. First is continuous process. In continuous process, finite forward of process and machines are limited. High volume manufacturing, or it is also called a manufacturing system which has some flexibility, and we produce high volume products over here. In this, we will have finite forward of line and machined limited. Medium volume manufacturing. Here, the volume of manufacturing is less in this type of process. It is an intermittent process, So we will have infinite forward of processes, labor and machine limited. And the last one is low volume manufacturing process. It is also known as job shop process, which is highly customized. And in this, we will have infinite forward of jobs, labor and some machines limited. Let's see typical scheduling and control functions. What are those? The first function of scheduling is allocating orders, equipment and personnel. Allocating orders means when we receive orders to complete, we have to decide which order should be uploaded first, what equipment should be allocated to for that particular order, and who will be completing the job. So the personnels are also allocated. Second is determining the sequence of order performance. So here sequencing is done according to the time taken by the activity to be completed and the due date on which you have to supply the product to the customer. Initiating performance of the scheduled work. Shop floor control. We will see this is also very important function of scheduling. Work center scheduling objectives are also very clear. The main objective is meet due dates, because when you will be able to meet due dates, then only the clients will be satisfied. We are supposed to minimize the lead time, because if you are able to minimize the lead time, then definitely the production in the given time will be maximum and the efficiency can be improved. Third is minimize setup time or cost. If you are able to minimize the setup time, because when one job is uploaded, another job may not be using the same kind of equipment, personnel. So you have to make certain changes to, and that changes will take some time, and that is called setup time. And it will also definitely reduce the cost of production. Minimize work in process inventory. As we know, the work in process inventory always increases the cost of the production. And production cost is basically a main component for competition. If the cost is more, you will be pricing more, and then to sustain in the market, it will be difficult for us to compete with the competitors. We are supposed to maximize the machine utilization, because machine has a lifetime, machine has a life, and if the machine is not properly utilized, then it will definitely raise the cost of production. Now let's see some priority rules for job sequencing. There are certain rules. If we will follow those rules, we will be definitely improving the efficiency of our system. The very common rule is first come, first served. So whatever order comes to you first has to be served first, right? And this is the most common rule used by almost every person in the real life. Then the second rule is shortest operating time. The job which has shortest operating time should be uploaded first. According to the third rule, that is the earliest due date first, means here we will see the due date, not the shortest operating time, not first come first serve. We will look at the due date. So whichever job has the due date first should be uploaded first. And then the fourth one is slack time remaining. I'll tell you what, how to calculate the slack time later. So if the less the slack time, the first will be the priority of uploading that. Slack time remaining per operation. So we will also see if the slack time is remaining less per operation, then we will upload accordingly, or we will make the rules accordingly. We will learn all these rules by taking certain examples in later in the slides. One more rule is, which is very important, that is basically the critical ratio. So first we will calculate the critical ratio, which has the formula which is on the slide: due date minus current date, number of days remaining. And the last is last come first served. In certain jobs we also use the very important method or rule of job sequencing, that is last come first served. Random order is also very important. Sometimes we use this random order. So now let's take some example of sequencing. Here is one example in front of you. There are four jobs: job A, job B, job C and D. The processing time for all the jobs is also given here: 4 for job A, 7 for job B, 3 for job C and 1 for job D. It is in days, right? Similarly, due date is also given. It is according to the client's requirement. So the due date for first is 5 days. For B, it is 10 days. For C, it is 6 days. And for D, it is 4 days. So now, suppose you have the 4 jobs to the right arrive for processing on one machine. So now, how will you arrange? How will you upload? So if we take the rule FCFS, that is the first come first serve, then what will be the total sequencing? So processing is done first come first serve, so A, B, C, D will be uploaded in the same sequence. Now you can see here the flow time is given here. So for first job A, which will be completed in 4 days, because processing time of first job is 4 days. Now the B will take 7 days, so we will be able to deliver B job after 11 days, as you can see here on the slide. 4 plus 7 equals to 11. Similarly, C takes 3 days, so 11 plus 3 equals to 14, and D takes 15 days, D takes 1 day, so 14 plus 1 is equals to 15. So the total time consumed to finish all the 4 jobs is basically 15 days. Now, do all the jobs get done on time? This is the question, because this you can see here, the due date for A is 5, so you are completing that job in 4 days. That means we can deliver job A on time, because client was requiring it on the 5th day, but we are delivering it on the 2nd or 4th day, right? But what about other jobs? B is also required in 10th day, but we are able to deliver it on 11th day. That means the B is not delivered on time. So jobs B, C and D are going to be late. So this is how we can finish this, right?
Now the second option is shortest operating time. So shortest operating time is, again we will be using the same jobs. Shortest operating time, if we arrange all the jobs according to the shortest operating time, so arrangement will be D, C, A and B. Do all the jobs get done on time? Again, similarly we can see it by flow time. No, jobs A and B are going to be late. A and B are going to be late. But now by using shortest operating time, it is very clear that we can fix at least two jobs on time. So earliest due date first. In this method we can see the sequence again, so according to the earliest due date first. So what was the due date? Earliest due date was for D. So D is kept first. Second due date, which was less, was 4 for A. For D it was 1, so we will put D first. For A it is 4, so second is A and third is C and fourth is B. Now let's see, by looking at the flow time, whether we are able to complete all the jobs on time or not, or how many jobs are completed within the due date. So again you can see jobs C and B are going to be late. C and B are going to be late. Now we can finish D and A on the given time. The critical ratio method. In this method, we will be calculating the CR. CR according to our formula. So for A, 5 minus 4 divided by 15. 15 is common for all, because the total time taken to complete all the four jobs will be 15. So for critical ratio for A is 0.06, for B it is 0.20, for C it is 0.20, and for D also it is 0.20. So now how many jobs can be done first? Since there is three-way tie, only the first job or two will be on time. Right? So no, we cannot finish all the jobs on time, but since there is a three-way tie, only the first job or two will be on time. Right? Last come first serve, there is no issue. You can sequence D came at the last, then C, then B, then A. But in this case also, are we able to finish the jobs on time? Here also, job B and A are going to be late. Now, there is also one method which is called Johnson's rule. In Johnson's rule is applicable when there are two stages. These four methods were used when the job is completed only in one stage. But when we look at the two stages or more than one stage, we have to use Johnson's rule. What is the job sequencing using Johnson's rule? Job first, select the job with the smallest time in either stage. So what is the smallest time? Smallest time is D. That is job D with the smallest time in the first stage. Place that job as early as possible. So in job sequences, we will place D first. Right? Now drop D out, select the next smallest time and place it fourth in the job or the last in the job. So last, A is placed at the last. Then drop A also, and then C. There is a tie in two stages for two different jobs. In this case, place the job with the smallest time in the first stage as early as possible in the unfilled job sequence. So B is kept first and then the remaining C can be placed first. So this will be the job sequencing. How the shop floor control is done? Assigning priority of each shop order. This is the, basically now we are discussing the shop floor control functions. maintaining work in process quantity information, conveying shop order status information to the office, providing actual output date for capacity control purpose, providing quantity by location by shop order for work in progress inventory and accounting purpose, providing measurement of efficiency, utilization and productivity of manpower and machines. Now input output control. Input work center and output, which is the fundamental model of operations. Planned input should never exceed planned output. Right? We should not bring the inventory which is more than the planned output. Focus attention on bottleneck work centers, as we have already discussed about the bottleneck in the previous lectures. There is a now principles of work center scheduling. There is a direct equivalence between workflow and cash flow. The effectiveness of any job shop should be measured by speed of flow through the shop. Schedule jobs as a string with the process step back to back. A job once started should not be interrupted. Speed of flow is most efficiently achieved by focusing on bottleneck, work center and job. Reschedule every day. Obtain feedback each day on jobs that are not completed at each work center. Match work center input information to what the worker can actually do. Now, the next is, when seeking improvement in output, look for incompatibility between engineering design and process execution. Certainty of standards, routing and so forth is not possible in a job shop, but always work towards achieving it. Personal scheduling in services means scheduling consecutive days off, scheduling daily work time, scheduling early work times. Now, let's do some questions and then you will have some clarification over here. Work center is what? A single machine? A group of machine? An area where a particular type of work is performed? All of the above. So what is the answer? So friends, here we have already discussed the work center is all of the above. Right? Next question. When work is assigned to a work center simply based on what is needed over time, we would refer to this as which of the following scheduling system? A finite loading of work, an infinite loading of work, forward scheduling, all of the above, none of the above. Answer is an infinite loading of work. Typical scheduling and controlling of operation include which of the following functions? Allocating orders at work center, is it the function or not? Allocating equipment at work center, allocating personnel at work center, all of the above, none of the above. So the answer here is all of the above. Typical scheduling and controlling of operation include which of the following function? Determining the job sequence, dispatching, expediting late and critical orders, all of the above, none of the above. So again, we can see the answer here, all of the above. Which of the following are standard measures of schedule performance used to evaluate priority rules? Meeting due dates, maximizing job flow time, maximizing inventory, all of the above, none of the above. Here you can see, nobody wants to maximize work in process. Do you want to maximize job flow time? Because both of these will increase your cost. So the answer is meeting due dates. Which priority rules uses the calculation of difference between the due date and the current date divided by the number of work days remaining? You know, short STR, no, SOT, no, due date, FCFS, none of the above. Now you have to decide, because we have just now studied. That is, none of the above. Correct answer is critical ratio. The major function of shop floor control are which of the following? Conveying shop order status, measuring efficiency, assigning priorities, maintaining work in progress quantity information, all of the above. So all of the above means A, B, C, D are correct answer, because it improves the efficiency and have a proper control over the shop floor. Which of the following are tools of shop floor control? Daily dispatch list, scrap reports, rework reports, all of the above, none of the above. So all of the above is the right answer. Daily dispatch list, scrap report, rework reports must be used to control the shop floor. Which of the following is principle of work center scheduling? There is a direct equivalence between workflow and cash flow. Certainty of routings are very possible in a shop. Reschedule only once a week, all of the above, none of the above. There is a direct equivalence between workflow and cash flow. Thank you.